The God of miracles, we just sang that beautiful and powerful chorus, one that we're familiar with. I want to ask you, how big can you think? How big can you think? We serve a big God who does big work in big ways. And I want to ask, do we believe that? Do we act on that? Or are we of the mindset that we have a God of miracles that we serve? And that we can see Him work miracles on our behalf. See, I'm afraid that in our modern Western civilization is that we are so self-sufficient and independent and we can do our own thing that sometimes we don't even think we need God, much less do we need God to come through with a miracle. And that shouldn't be our mindset, ladies and gentlemen. Jesus specializes in doing big things. And things that we would think are impossible, and we need to be in on that. I think back over the 28 plus years that my wife and I have been at Thompson Station Church, and when we started here, there were two couples in their 60s, a couple 28 and 30 with a 4 and a 6-year-old. And Leanne and I joined them. The 10 of us just went ahead with God. And I just think year after year after year in resources and finances and facilities and servant leaders and lay people and worship leaders and teachers and people coming alongside and having a heart for missions. And I've seen it over and over and over again how God has done amazing big things. And now it's being expanded across the world. You'll hear more about that today. And we have a team going to Uruguay this month. And then we've got a church plant in Las Vegas and Cincinnati, the campus in Columbia, our Thompson Station campus. They're all going in big ways and great things are happening. And God is working in big ways. And I want us today, all of us, during today's message from His Word, I want us to ask God to stretch our minds and to grow our faith and to believe God for big things in our personal lives, our family life, and in our church life. We don't serve a small God who's stuck in a box and limited. We serve an unlimited God who is not captured or held or contained by time nor space. And we need to have the faith that God who worked miracles yesterday, who is the same God yesterday, today, and tomorrow, will work today miracles on our behalf, not so that we could gain any prestige or position, but that He might bring glory to Himself. Jesus never fed. We're going to talk about feeding the 5,000. He didn't feed 5,000 so anybody could brag on Him just to say that's just a good trick. He did that to bring people to God through Him. And any miracle He worked, it wasn't a magic trick. It was always for the spiritual well-being of the person involved and for the glory of God. That's what you and I live for. For the glory of God, that's the upper tier. Remember in the upper tier, the glory of God is first and foremost. And then connecting people with Jesus to experience His greater life. That's our mission. The question that we've been answering for about 4 weeks, the series title, Who is Jesus? That's the question. Today, one more time, we answer that question with this as our message. Jesus is the miracle worker. The miracle worker. If you have your copy of God's Word, either hard copy or electronic copy on iPad or phone, would you hold it in your hand? And I want us to take a commitment together. Make this covenant with me. Repeat after me. We haven't done it in a while, but I want to do it this morning. I believe the Bible. It is the Word of God. Every word of God is true. Where what the Bible says differs from my beliefs, my behavior, my actions or attitudes, I will change by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You see, we believe in the inerrancy of Scripture, and we believe in the sufficiency of Christ, the one and only Savior of the world. So we believe in the Holy Spirit who fills us. And so we say, Jesus, teach us today from Your Word that is true. Holy Spirit, guide us and guard us and set our feet on the path that you designed for us. John chapter 6, verse 1. John 6, 1. After these things, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and a great multitude was following him because they were seeing the signs which he was performing on those who were sick. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Jesus, therefore, lifting up his eyes and seeing a great multitude was coming to him, said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread that all these many may eat?" And this he was saying to test Philip, for Jesus himself knew what he was intending to do. Philip answered and said, 200 denarii worth, that's 8 months, 9 months worth of wages, is not sufficient to buy bread for all of them, even to receive just a little bit. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to Jesus, "There is a boy, a lad here, who has 5 pieces of bread, 5 barley loaves, and 2 fish. But what are these for so many people?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in a number of about 5,000 men. So we got to count their wives and kids as well. Jesus, therefore, took the loaves, and having given thanks, he distributed to those who were seated, likewise also of the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they were filled, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost." So they were gathered up and filled 12 baskets, the leftovers from the 5 barley loaves, which were left by those who had eaten. Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence here today. Teach us from your word, God. Fill my mind, my mouth, my heart with you, Lord. May the words I say bring glory to your name and challenge us. May Lord, they only be your words chosen by you. Help me. I yield to all of me, my mind, my will, my emotions, to you as a tool, an instrument. Oh God, wield me in a way that pleases you, and I thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me share some thoughts from this miraculous multiplication passage about Jesus, our Savior. Thought number one, Jesus challenges all of us corporately and each of us individually to think big, to not be limited, not be small, not be confined in what we believe God can and wants to do. He saw the crowd. He said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for all these people?" Now, there's nothing small about our Savior, and there's nothing small about the work of our Savior or the ministry of our Savior. Jesus works in big ways, and he calls his followers and his church to work in big ways too. Now, Jesus and Philip are standing on this grassy hillside on the north by northwest side of the Sea of Galilee, the Lake of Gennesaret, Tiberias Sea, whatever you name it. I was just there, as you know, a couple of weeks ago in this area, local area. And Jesus says to Philip, "Look at all these. So if the men, most of them had wives and several had kids, what if there were 12 or 15 or 18,000 people?" And he's looking out. He said, "How are we going to feed all these people?" Philip thinks, it would take 9 months' salary to buy the food. And he's thinking, we don't have that kind of money. There's no town close by. Jesus, even if there was a town and even if we had the money, we don't have the donkeys and the carts. You can't fit enough food for all these people in a backpack, Jesus. This is not going to happen. This is an impossible task. Jesus is challenging us. When you face a situation that's daunting, overwhelming, a mountain before you, and you think, "I don't have the strength, I don't have the knowledge, I don't have the finance, I don't have the wherewithal to meet this challenge," and instead of being defeated, we ought to think, "Oh, I can't, but he can." We ought to think, "God is able. For with Christ, nothing is impossible." Jesus challenges us. Just like he was challenging Philip, let's think big and believe in miracles. I mean, either God is who he says he is, or let's not do this. God says, I'm the same yesterday and today and tomorrow. He doesn't change. I change not. And he calls us to himself and he says, hey, I want to be in your life and I want to show you my power through your life, through your family, through your church, challenging us to think big. The beauty in this is when we do that, there's no way to lose, ladies and gentlemen. No way to lose. Why? Look at verse 6. Jesus already has his plan in his mind. He already has the plan in place, a big plan in place. Verse 6, he asked this only to test Philip, for Jesus already knew what he was going to do. Ladies and gentlemen, when you face some obstacle before you, don't fret over it because God already has the solution in mind. Here's the beauty of it. You don't have to say, well, I wonder if God can fix this. I wonder if God can resolve this. He's already got the resolution in his heart. He wants to play it out through you. Nothing surprises God. You're facing the hardest time of your life. Maybe it's physical illness. Maybe it's cancer. Maybe it's loss of a loved one. Maybe it's some financial difficulty in your family, some strain, some relationship that's not going well. And you think, oh my goodness, Lord, do you know about this? Of course he does. Did it ever occur to you that nothing ever occurred to God? God knows already. He's got the plan in place. Sometimes we see a situation and we feel overwhelmed and we think there's no way out. And the big problem with when we feel that way is we're leaving Jesus out of the equation. You know, when we do that, basically what we're doing is we're saying we don't have any faith. We're saying the God of the universe, Jesus Christ, according to Colossians 1, who set the stars in space and the earth on its axis, we're thinking, oh my goodness, that God is not big enough to solve my eeny-weeny-teeny-leeny problem. Now, it's not eeny-weeny-teeny-weeny to you, but it is to him. Ladies and gentlemen, don't leave Jesus out of the equation. He already has a big plan in mind to bring the solution about. Jesus knows your impossible situation, and he's coming, and he's already has plans for a miracle. But however, our difficulty, our situation is often our thinking, our faith, ladies and gentlemen, we have to confess, if we're honest, it's just too small. Our thinking and our faith is small. Philip, here's Philip. He represents us. You may not like to admit it, but from time to time, you're just like Philip. Lord, it would take more than 8 months' wages to buy enough food for everyone just to have a bite. This can't happen, Jesus. Judas has the money bag, and there's not near enough money in there. It's sad that sometimes our first thought is, it can't happen, rather than God can do anything. That ought to be our first thought. God can do anything. God can do anything. Sometimes we think small. Now, look, face whatever you want, a business problem, a family situation, a financial, whatever it is. I got to be honest. Sometimes, I don't write it down, but sometimes my mind begins to make a mental list of all the reasons this can't work out. Sometimes my mind begins to make a, that can't work out because of this. You know, the timing's not right. The finances are right. We don't have the right people in place. They're too stubborn, or they hurt. That it's not going to be resolved. And we make a. Now, don't hang me out to dry. Am I the only guy that ever has that mental list? Is there anybody out here that would say I have that from time to time? Thank you. Thank you, Wes. Thank you. The last service, nobody helped me. I mean, they hung me out to dry. I mean, like all 300 said it was, yeah, it's just you, Tom. The rest of us got full of faith. Whoop, whoop. Thank you, middle service, for letting me know that you are just as frail and human as I am. But we need to challenge ourselves. We need to challenge ourselves. We can't be satisfied with small thinking or small faith, and we can't spend our time on the negative side making the list of why it can't be done. Let me tell you, I don't care if you list 1,000 reasons why it can't. Let me give you one reason why it can. Jesus. You can take all the pile of all the stacks of computer-generated reasons or history. Listen, just because it was one way in the past doesn't mean it has to be that way in the future. You understand that? Tomorrow has not yet come. I don't care what bondage, what difficulty, what addiction, what struggle you or somebody you love deals with, yesterday does not determine your tomorrow. And Jesus can grab hold of that and change it in an instant. Let's break out of this small thinking, this small faith. We have a God, we have a Savior who specializes in doing big things in big ways. Miraculous multiplication takes place when Jesus puts his hand in the process. Let's ask God to deliver us from small thinking and small faith. Here's a fourth thought I want to share with you. We need to sincerely offer whatever we have to Jesus. Okay? Now let's look at verse 9, 8 and 9. I hope you got your Bibles. I'm still in my text. Another of the disciples, Andrew, that's Peter's brother, he spoke up. Verse 9. Jesus, we have a boy here, a lad here, and he was kind enough to bring his five hush puppies and his two crappie to offer us. That's in Dixon translation. Five hush puppies and two crappie. And he's trying to be offer, but then he goes back into that yesterday. Remember that negative? But how is this going to help among so many? It's true. You know, in the life of faith, you have to acknowledge there are some facts. You do. But you also have to acknowledge that because we serve a God who's not bound by time or space, who's omnipotent and omniscient, he's all-powerful and all-knowing and everywhere, he is not contained by the facts. The fact is, you can't walk on water. Yes, you can. Jesus did it. Fact is, you can't raise the dead. Yes, you can. Jesus did it. Not only did Jesus do it, Paul did it. Fact is, you can't take five hush puppies and two crappie and feed 15,000. Oh, you can't? Yes, you can. Jesus touched it. Yes, you acknowledge. I'm not saying to be an idiot. I don't know if that's a bad word. I can't say S-T-U-P-I-D. That's a bad word in my house. Always has been. But you can't just say that those facts aren't there. Yes, they are. Deal with them in your intellect. Deal with them the best you can. But there are times when you need Jesus, who's not bound by facts, to enter into the equation. He changes everything. He changes everything. That's what happened in this instance. So whatever we have, let's give it to the Lord. We have limited talent, limited time, limited ability, but whatever we have, let's give it to the Lord. And when we do that, when we say, God, this is what we have, this is what I have, maybe this is what my Connect group has, Lord, would you use us? We give our time, we give whatever talent, we give whatever resources we can, and God, use our group and multiply it to the ends of the earth. How about your Connect class? Are you doing anything missional? Are you taking anything local? Next Saturday, you know, maybe you can't go as a group around the world. Some of our classes do, but maybe you can't or it doesn't work this year. Next Saturday, we're going to feed some lower economic families that have limited resources of food. And our church is going to help feed them one generation away. We'll tell you, could you help us next Saturday for 3 hours? What do? You walk with a person as they get groceries, and then you pray with them and ask them where they are. Could you take 3 hours to do that next Saturday in Columbia? That's a ministry. We got some mission teams going out. And they're raising funds. Uruguay. Could you say, God, I'll give what I have? I can't give everything, but I can give something. You know, right now, as of this morning, we had 39 children in Haiti, a mission of grace that we partner with. There were 39 kids, listen, that still needed sponsorship. It's $200 a year. Leanne and I, we've been sponsoring since Sam and Bobby's wife and Angela and them. Sanja, it's under the lights. It's hard, I'm sorry. But since these beautiful ladies went down there, God grabbed their hearts, they came back and told us about Leanne. I've been sponsoring a child for whatever, 4 years or however long they've been going. Listen, there's 39 kids still And if you'll sponsor $200 a year, they get a nutritious meal, they get their school books, they get a uniform, they get encouraged. You help sponsor them. That makes sure they have one delicious, nutritious meal a day in that school. Now listen, I don't want that to be here after this service. You hear me? I don't want that to be here. Let me let you on a secret. The first service is less than half the size of you. They already did 18. There's only 21 left. But if you go to the 21 and you still want to help, there are other ways you can help. But I don't want those kids to be unsponsored after this service. Is that okay? Can I say that? I need you to do that. Leanne and I have been doing it. We sponsor other places and do other things. I need y'all's help. Now, so we need to sincerely offer what we can. You can't give $200,000. You can't even give $2,000. Could you give $200 to help feed a kid and clothe a kid and give kid books for an education in a terribly depressed, hard place called Haiti? I think we'll do that. Here's number five. Get organized for ministry. I love this. I love this because, you know, sometimes people think being Spirit-led is being foolish. It's nothing to it. They're not equated. We are a Spirit-filled church. We're a Spirit-led church. But that doesn't mean we don't organize for ministry. Look what Jesus did. We're following the example of our Savior. Look at verse 10. Get organized for ministry. Have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass on that place. They sat down. 5,000 men, 4,000 wives, 3,000 kids, 12,000 people. There's probably more than that. That's probably minimum. 12,000 on the hillside. What you don't read here, by the way, is this particular miracle, this work of God, is recorded in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Not all of them are, but this one's in all four synoptic Gospels. So in chapter 6 of Mark, verse 39, Jesus directed them to have the people sit down, and more specifically, on the grass, more specifically, and they sat in groups of 100s and 50s. Now, why did Jesus do that? Because Jesus had every intention that not one child, not one teenager, not one man, not one woman would go unfed that day. And if you just start throwing the food out to 15,000 when they're just in a mass, somebody gets left out. And so he put them in groups of 50 and groups of 100, and each group of 50 and each group of 100 had a disciple that helped organize that little group, and they took their food. And so here it is. I mean, you see the picture? Jesus has this boy's crappie and hush puppies in a basket, and he's putting his hands in like that, and then he's just throwing it in baskets. And matter of fact, he's throwing it in this basket. I don't know how that happens to feed 15,000 people. I imagine when he put his hands like this and put it in another basket, and I think the disciples took their hands and threw it in another basket, took their hands, and every time they took out, it was like the widow's oil and the widow's meal. It just didn't run out. And then pretty soon, they're just throwing it out in the handful. And then they put it in a bucket, and they're bucketing it out of a barrel. And every person gets fed. They get organized, and they do ministry. I mentioned your Connect class. Is your Connect class organized? Are you praying specifically for missions locally, like One Generation Away, or Unchained Movement, or many others that we hear? Are you praying nationally? Are you as a Connect group, or do you have any ties? Do you have any heart for our church plan in Las Vegas? Would you go out and help Steve next summer do a backyard Bible club, prayer walk in the neighborhood? Would you go to Cincinnati next summer, six of you? Doesn't have to be all 30 of you, six of you. The others of you pray and help pay for the way. Would you go help Steve? Could you go down and do some ministry next Saturday, this One Generation Away, giving away food to needy families? Their organization, we're organized. Get in that organization and be a part of the ministry that we do. And when we do these things, we see here in God's Word what happens. Jesus will do an amazing big work, a multiplication miracle, if you will. Look at verse 11, still in my text. Jesus then took the loaves, he gave thanks, he prayed over it, he blessed it, and he distributed those who were seated as much as they wanted. You get that? As much as they wanted. They didn't get a morsel. They didn't get like one bite. They didn't get one chicken McNugget. They had all they wanted. And they did the same with the fish. And they had all had enough to eat. And then said to his disciples, gather up all that's left over so that nothing be wasted. God doesn't waste. Verse 13, they gathered up and filled 12 baskets with pieces of the loaves, the five barley loaves left over. 5,000, 10,000, 15,000 people ate, and there's 12 baskets left over. Now, there's no proof of this, but I read some commentators that said 12 baskets. Why 12? Because the heart of Jesus is to always love people. Maybe he took the 12 baskets and he handed one to first disciple, second disciple, Andrew. How about Peter? How about Mark? And he handed them out. He said, you guys have given so much and you spend so many nights on the road and sleeping outside under the stars with me using a pillow for a rock. Why don't you take 24 hours, take this home to your wife, and this basket's going to feed your wife and kids 3 or 4 days. That would have been very meaningful. You and I don't understand what a basket of food means to us. When you go to the New Testament and you read in the book of Matthew, the Lord's Prayer, you ever thought on why it says, give us this day our daily bread, instead of give us this day our monthly bread? Ladies and gentlemen, in the day of Jesus, they didn't go to Costco and shop for a month like you do. Two reasons why I think it says daily bread. One is to teach us that we ought to have our daily provision from the Lord. But the other is highly practical. You understand, in the day of Jesus, they didn't have a whole lot of bank account so they could shop a month at a time. If these fishermen didn't catch fish on the Sea of Galilee, their kids may not eat that night. They feed them a little fish, take the leftover fish, trade them for a little corn, a little meal, feed them for a little vegetable, and that's how they had their daily bread. So friends, we need to trust God to do amazing miracles. And these 12 baskets are just one more expression. Not only does he love the multitudes, he loves the ministers. He loves the disciples. He loves those of you who serve in his church. And he's going to meet your needs. Wow, this is a multiplication miracle by Jesus. And I love verse 11. Look at verse 11, you got your Bible. And those who were seated ate as much as they wanted. What I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, this was not the bag of peanuts on the airplane flight from Nashville to Orlando. Now, have you ever got a bag of peanuts? You over had 3 peanuts in it? I mean, that's enough just to make your taste buds mad. This is not pretzels in a bag on a flight. This is a buffet. This is the Golden Corral buffet. Dig in. More than enough. That's the God we serve. Don't you dare take our great big God who makes a universe. Think about it. He makes a universe. He makes galaxy upon galaxy, and we're still discovering how big it is, and see that he decides it's so big and he only puts people in his image on one planet. Because it's not a big deal. And people come to me and say, if God, who made all these galaxies in this huge universe beyond understanding, why would he go to all that trouble and only put people on one planet? And my response is, what trouble? There's no trouble for God. How does he get a galaxy? Let there be a galaxy. Next. God is a God of provision. He works miracles. He multiplies. He works big. And we ought to work big and think big and believe big. Let me summarize the message. 3 words. Word number 1, give. The boy gave 5 pieces of bread, 2 little pieces of fish. The boy gave. Pray. Ask Jesus to touch it. Ask God to touch it. So he's got pray. So Jesus prays over and blesses it. We ought to pray over all that we have in resources and talent and time. And then what do? You don't give and pray and sit. You give and pray and you go. You go. Those disciples went. Can you imagine when Jesus is just scraping out this bread and fish and they got their baskets headed to their 50? Whoa, look, I get to take the provision that God brings. I get to be a part of this miracle. Go with a smile on your face, joy in your heart, saying, I'm participating in the work of God. Go. It's not complicated. Give, pray, go. I mentioned the feeding in Colombia, in the rougher parts of Colombia. You give as a church, by the way. Every time you give an offering, it goes, all of it goes to missions. All of it goes to ministry. All of it is to help the kingdom. We give $1,000 every time they do the food distribution. But the man in Columbia who runs that is gifted and talented and blessed by the Lord. That $1,000 turns into $16,000 of retail worth of food. That's the kind of deals that God lets him get. Your $1,000 turns into $16,000. You understand? That's a multiplication miracle. You know how many people are fed with that? Between 250 and 275 families. This is the feeding in Columbia, I think. Is this the second picture? There's the first picture, I think. There's a family, a lady in the middle. Oh, look at the blue shirt on the left-hand side. Our people walking and praying as they're getting their groceries. Go on to the next pic. Here's some servants. Another one of our shirts on the left, packing the bags. And here's the last picture, food distribution and teams of people that serve it. I mean, that's awesome. That's just one ministry we're in part of. What about another ministry? I mentioned the children in Haiti that we help. That our ladies got us started in 4, 5, 6 years ago. Well, at our last vacation Bible school and then at our missions conference, we packed food. We brought in an organization that specializes in it. You as a church, listen, gave $7,000. And out of that $7,000, we packed 30,000 meals. Look at a couple of pictures here. These are the young folks right here packing their meals. And just enjoying it upstairs in the C building. This next picture. Here's some other young folks, a little bit, not quite as young, but some other young folks. It was a family affair, grandparents and aunts and uncles and young people packing. These meals are set aside with protein and nutrients and minerals. And then the last picture, these are boxes that were shipped out, 30,000 meals. Now, some of you bankers and mathematicians already done it. 30,000 meals from $7,000 investment. That's 23 cents a meal, by the way. How many of y'all can do that? I can't make a meal for 23 cents. And look at that. Here's a meal. You want to talk about multiplication? God can take your 1,000 and make 16,000 out of it. God can take your 7,000 and make 30,000 meals at 23 cents a meal. And your giving, your generosity is feeding children in Haiti and helping underprivileged families in Colombia. Think big, ladies and gentlemen. God is in the multiplication miracle business, and you're in it too. You're in this miracle multiplication business. 2 weeks ago when we were in Israel, we always meet the three messianic churches. We see the sites, but we meet churches because less than 1% of the Jewish nation are Christians. You may not know that. But how can God's chosen people, only 1%, know He's Messiah? We're helping. So one of these particular messianic churches we met with has a prayer tower in a tall building praying over the city of Tel Aviv. You may not know this, but every boy and every girl, when they graduate from high school in Israel, every Israeli boy serves 3 years of military, every girl 2 years, mandatory. So Deborah, the daughter of a messianic pastor in Tel Aviv named Evi, his daughter Deborah, she's only like 22 or 23, gave her testimony, and I'll tell it short. Deborah was 18, just got out of high school, went into the military. By the time she's 19, her second year, 15 months removed from high school, she's 19, and she is leading a group I'm having trouble thinking this morning. She's in charge of Border Patrol Scout. She's a scout with Scout Group. That's her work. And so she was trained in combat, but she led a team of 25 to 30 that did scouting on the border looking. They're surrounded by some hostile countries there in Israel, always cautious of attack. So she one night, she and one other girl about her same age, so you're talking about two teenage girls in a pill box with all the scouts out there on doing patrolling. She got a call on the wire. She's not connected. She's not connected in wires. She's not have radios to her scouts. They've been sent out. They come back. She got a call from her commander and said, there's about to be a terrorist raid attack right in your area. And you have to get manually. You have to go out in the field and bring the scouts back one at a time. You got to get to them and send them back to this PO box, to this protected bunker station. And here's Deborah. She's 19, the son of a pastor, loving Jesus. And there's another girl her age right here who's under her command. One of them has to go out and manually tell, but one has to stay to listen to the command. And she's in charge. She has to make the decision who goes out. Deborah said, I'm 19, never been married. Never had a family. Never lived my life. I don't want to die. But she says, I look over at that girl who's under my charge, and I know she's not a Christian. Says, if she dies, she doesn't go to heaven. If I die, I go to heaven. And she says, I'm putting on my Kevlar vest, and I'm strapping on my helmet, and I'm trying not to cry. And I'm thinking, I could die this night. I don't want to die. I've got a life to live. But I can't be responsible for sending another girl who might die without Jesus. And she puts her M16 over her shoulder, and she goes out and gets every one of these scouts on the border. And she gets to talking real fast in English, which is not her native tongue, but they're mostly good English, but her native tongue is Hebrew. And she starts saying a word we don't understand, and she's going, zing, 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 pew. And she's using a word we don't understand, and she turns to her father, and her father says, bullets, bullets. And she says, bullets are flying. Here's a 19-year-old girl running through a firefight. Miraculously, every scout she's in charge of makes it back to safety. And then she says this, I'll never forget it. She says, that night, when bullets are flying and I'm running to get the people that report to me back into the safety of the pill box, the bunker, she said, somebody was praying for Israel. And that's me. Somebody's praying for me, and I'm alive. Somebody's praying. I knew somebody was praying for me. And what I tell you this morning, Thompson Station Church, somebody in Haiti, some mom who's got a baby who's sick, who just can't be made well at home, they're wanting some medicine, and they're going to get it from Mission of Grace, and they're praying, and you're the answer to that prayer. Some little child who doesn't have the money to go to school, they don't have food, they don't have books, they don't have a uniform, they don't have shoes, and they're praying. And you're going to be an answer to that child's prayer. Some mama down in Colombia who's on welfare, but it just doesn't make enough to really take care of her kids or grandkids, and she's praying. Friends, you're the answer to that prayer. What greater privilege in life than to be an answer to a prayer for some underprivileged family that's just beaten down by the terrible state in Haiti or the Dominican or Colombia or wherever. You are the answer. You're the answer to Steve Witt and Reagan's prayer. You gave the finances. You go and do ministry and planting churches in these cities. I can't tell you how great an honor it is when we get to be the answer to a prayer. Kim, who works for Miss Lynn and helps direct a lot of the ministry at Mission of Grace, she just wants to send you a word. We pack these boxes. It's not greatly professional, but it's heartfelt. Would you listen as Kim shares?
Hi there, Pastor Dwayne and Thompson Station Church in Tennessee. We just want to thank you so much for all the efforts you guys put in to send us this food. We just received it today, and we know it's going to feed so many families, and we've been able to send some into the south also, where the hurricane, a lot of damage happened in the hurricane. So thank you so much for taking the time to pack this for us, and we're so excited to be able to distribute it and use it in the mission. Thank you so much.